Hi, sister, how you going?
Hey, sister, I'm just fine. I see Aya behind you.
Hello. What are you doing there? Oh, hello, you cheeky. Say hello.
Morning, sister.
Morning. How are you doing?
Yeah, good. Yourself?
Sister Phyllis.
Just excellent. Excellent. I'm trying to figure something out. There's something in the middle of my screen.
Hey, brother.
Hey, how you doing there? Mate? Good to see you. All right, what's everybody up to?
I'm just letting the little one say hello.
Yeah.
And then I'll get lost.
Don't touch that. Oh, what's happening?
Oh, my. Oh, she is so sweet.
Yes.
Hello. Hello. Can you see me?
She's looking at the earphone. She can hear you.
Oh.
It's a very good connection.
Yeah, it is. Hello. What you doing today? Did you just get up and have breakfast? Huh? What did you have for breakfast? What did you have for breakfast?
We really liked the branches of Yahusha. Was awesome.
Like it?
Yes.
Oh, good.
I particularly thought the children were amazing.
Yeah.
They're amazing.
Oh,
he gets those messages before I do, so by the time I got the message, I didn't have time to really watch anything, so I'll watch it later.
Yeah. Well,
how y'all been doing?
I'm going to get out of here. Love you guys.
Okay.
All right. Bye, Bobby.
See you guys. Love you.
Love you. Bye.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
Won't drown the baby this week.
Okay. How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
Just fine. I've just been had a really wonderful couple of days because it's, you know, because we had Sabbath, you know, and two Sabbaths in a row. I don't usually get to have two Sabbaths in a row. It was really fun.
It's nice, isn't it?
It was. I really enjoyed it.
You look great.
Well, thank you.
You look really rested and just like really, really good.
Yeah. Well, thank you. And you look fine yourself. You always do.
Okay.
Shirt to wear.
Oh, thank you. It's been a while since we have talked.
Yes, it
it's
is.
Been about a month.
Yeah. I think I'm going to enjoy having more time because it'll give more things to talk about. I felt like when we were seeing each other so often, I felt like I was just repeating myself, saying the same thing over and over again.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it's good. Okay, well, I guess we have to say welcome to everyone. So welcome, brothers and sisters, to the Real Women of TORAH. That way. Today, I thought we'd talk a bit about, I'm Amy Davidson. I think that's the new thing now. We have to introduce ourselves. So if you'd like to introduce yourself, sister?
Oh, yeah. I'm Phyllis, and I wanted to talk today a little bit about persecution and a history of what we went through as a family with persecution.
Wonderful. Sounds great. Fill us in.
Okay. Do you want me to start? Okay.
Yes.
Well, when I think of persecution, I think about how when we were Christians and we were members of a congregation, Lou was baptized. All three of us were baptized into this congregation, and everything was wonderful. There was no persecution. There was no pressure. We agreed with everybody, and everything was just wonderful. In fact, as a Christian, there wasn't even persecution from my coworkers that I worked with that were non-Christian, because we just got along with everybody. We didn't even think about, they didn't talk about persecution really much in that organization. But once we learned the truth and we started keeping things, the true name and keeping the commandments and everything, that's when we started learning persecution. And suddenly we didn't get along with anybody. You know, it was the Christians didn't like us, the non-Christians. And that, you know, that kind of got my attention, like, okay, we were. And it, what comes to mind is when Yahushua said, narrow is the gate. Well, he said, broad is the path that leads to destruction, and narrow is the gate by which you must enter into for righteousness. And I know that's not an exact quote, but you know what, you've heard it. And so I thought about that. I said, that path we were on, the Christian path, was the broad path. And now we're on this very narrow path because he said, few enter in. Because I'm telling you, there, at that time, we were so isolated. We didn't have the internet back then. And there was nobody that agreed with us, that knew what we were talking about. And we were persecuted by the Christians and the non-Christians, both. We were totally isolated. And that, you know, it just reminded me of Matthew 5:10, where he said, blessed are those persecuted for righteousness' sake, because theirs is the reign of the heavens. And blessed are you when they reproach and persecute you and falsely say every wicked word against you for my name's sake. Well, for my sake. And he says, rejoice and be glad, because your reward in the heavens is great. For in this way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. So that was my first clue, really, that we were on the right path, is because now we're getting persecuted. Now we're suffering. And 1 Peter says, but even if you suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed, and do not fear their threats, neither be troubled. So as we grew in the truth and associated with more messianics, it was easier to bear the persecution of our friends, because we had other people to look through, to look to and associate. So we started, again, collecting together with just people that were like-minded. But, you know, who knew that the persecution among messianics was going to be worse than any persecution I ever felt, you know, 20 years ago when we first turned away from our Christian belief. I mean, the messianic so-called brothers and sisters, I mean, they're it's more vicious than anything I ever experienced before. So that's, you know, but I guess that means we should be rejoicing even more, because it's more persecution. But it was really rough. I tell you, when we first turned into the truth, that was the hardest thing, is because if we shared or told anybody how we believed, and I know there's a lot of men and women that experience this. They call me all the time on the phone and say, you know, I told my family, I told my friends, and then now they won't talk to me. They won't have anything to do with me. And they just call me names, and they just won't listen to me, you know. And I know what that feels like. And I just tell them, I said, well, that just means you're on the right path. Because Yahushua said, if they persecuted me, they shall persecute you too.
Yeah. Wonderful. What can some, like, what have you been doing to sort of handle it? How do you handle it? Have you been, what would you tell someone to sort of do if they were getting that? And has it ever gotten so, when we talk about persecution these days, has it ever gotten to the point where it's become physical or you're scared for your life or anything like that? And how do you handle it then? Because I know you can see rejoice, but it's a lot harder to do when you're going through things like that.
It is. When you're in the midst of it, the first advice I give people is to tone it down. If people are just not wanting to talk to you, because what you're doing is you're destroying your own witness. If you were so gung-ho, and that's what we were. We were just so excited and so gung-ho that we destroyed our witness to these people. But have I ever felt... No, you know what? I'm so protected. I've had a few emails where people threatened me, and you know, and I guess the emotional effect was the worst part of it. But you know, like you said, it's hard to just say rejoice, rejoice. But really and truly, if you can just do that, you know, he said that he will bless those who bless you, and he will curse those who curse you. And you know, we can bless those who, in Romans 12:14, it says, bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse. So if someone's cursing you or, you know, mistreating you, the best thing you can do is love them back and pray for them. You know, they might just tune you out and not listen to anything that you had to say, but you can just pray for them, because praying for them will teach you to love them and understand human nature, basically, is what you're getting to know a little bit more about what Yahushua felt. I mean, imagine how it felt. I mean, literally, I've had to tell people on the phone that are upset. I said, just picture Yahushua, what he went through when they were spitting on him and pulling his beard and beating him, you know, and he did nothing. He was totally innocent. So nobody's pulled my beard or spit on me or beat me. And they can't hurt me, because if Yahushua is for you, how can anyone be against you?
Yeah.
So you just have to cry out. And I've done that a couple of times. I have cried out to Yahuwah for a defender. I just felt like this person crossed the line. In my heart, I felt like this person needed to be taken down a notch, you know. But of course, that's not our place to do it. So I just cried out to Yahuwah, and I literally said, oh, Father, I need a defender. This just hurts too much. I need a defender. And my son Adam was home. And I said, Adam, can you come up here? I just need to talk to you. And he says, the only reason it's bothering you is because you're becoming emotional over it. He says, there's nothing to be emotional about. It's just, you know, facts and figures. Well, girls are more emotional than that. And that helped a lot. And then later on that day, there was Brother Colin, I think, he responded to that same person, because that same person was sending me that ugly email, sent copies out to several people. And Brother Colin, he jumped to my defense. And I thought, thank you, Father. That was, you know, I cried out for a defender. And Brother Colin is always so kind. Every time I read one of his emails, whether he's just answering a question or, you know, taking a stand, there's so much love and kindness and gentleness that exude from his emails. I know you've talked to him,
yeah.
You know, because you were Skyping with him, and he's just such a kind, gentle person. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I didn't mean to get off on that, but
yes.
you know, it's just like what Yahusha said. You will know one another by the love you have for one another.
Yeah,
you know, and the people who are persecuting, I don't feel any love there, you know, and I'm not, you know, I don't know about people that they like, if, you know, like-minded people like them, but, you know, what we have to do is we bless those who persecute us, and we rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep. Be of the same mind toward one another. Do not be proud in mind, but go along with the lowly. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Repay no one evil for evil. Respect what is right in the sight of all men. If possible, on your part, be at peace with all men. Beloved, do not revenge yourselves, but give place to the wrath. For it has been written, vengeance is mine, and I shall repay, says Yahuwah. Instead, if your enemy hungers, feed him. If he thirsts, give him a drink. For in so doing, you shall heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So that is my advice.
Wonderful.
And that comes, let's see if I lost my screen here. Lou helped me. I asked Lou before I came, I said, will you help me gather some verses together, and he was so kind about doing it. This is from Romans 12:1-21.
Okay, fantastic. Is there ever a time where it's okay to be angry?
Is there ever a time, what about anger?
Is there ever a time when it's okay to be angry?
Absolutely not. No, you cannot. I don't think you should be angry. Because if you're getting angry, you're taking it personally. I do get angry. I'm not perfect. I got angry, you know. But I don't think we're supposed to get angry, really.
Yeah.
I'm not sure really how to answer that question, because I know at one point Yahuwah says, "Be angry, but do not sin in your anger, and don't let your anger stay overnight." So I guess it is, you know, right, there is such a thing as righteous anger, but anger is another emotion that I think of. If you're angry, I think response.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you feel anger and you can hold it inside, but not if that anger is going to come forth and come out of you in any way or form. If you vocalize it or take action by doing something, no, that's not good.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can feel anger, but you need to take that anger to Yahusha.
Yeah. Wonderful. That's fantastic. I've sort of run out of questions on that.
Okay. Well, then
Luke
gave me some more ideas to think
Great.
About.
Yes.
Moshe tells Israel before entering the land. This is Deuteronomy 31:6. Be strong and courageous. Do not fear nor be afraid of them, for it is Yahuwah your Elohim who is going with you. He does not fail you nor forsake you. And in Genesis 28:15, it says, and see, I am with you and shall guard you wherever you go, and shall bring you back to this land. For I am not going to leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. So, you know, he tells us time and time again that he will not desert us. You know, that he will always be with us. And, you know, can I backtrack and go back to my experience with, like I said, because when I think of the persecution I've experienced, not just the persecution that we're going through right now, which, like I said, seems to be a lot more vicious than what I experienced through Christians. But I remember I used to be part of heading up or helping out with a homeschool group because I homeschooled my boys. And I was, you know, in with the Christian clique of, it was a very Christian organization. And so I was very active in that. And then when that was right when the Harry Potter movies, or books, not the movies, but the books, the first one or two had just come out. And all these Christians, they were just going on and on and on about Harry Potter, how much their child loved it and helped it. And so that's when I started jumping in and expressing my opinion. And I was amazed that how, you know, and these Christians, you would think that they would know witchcraft when they saw it. But they, oh, well, there's no harm in it. And then, you know, and then it started little things like when Halloween came up and I was telling them how bad Halloween was. Well, everybody's, and that's how I started getting a reputation for being strange, you know, because this is harmless. It doesn't mean that. And of course, you know, Christmas, EASTER. And finally, I just got kicked out of the group. Oh. There was one person there who was, she was a very sweet, sweet Christian also. But she came to me and she said, you know, I just have to tell you, these people, they just don't want you to be around them anymore. But she said, no matter what, I still love you. And she would maintain and continue to be my friend in spite of, you know, how these other people ostracized me. Well, I kind of drifted away from the group after that. It was just too much. And she left and moved away. And so that was the end of my, there wasn't anything for me anymore. But that was the thing I kept holding on to, because that was really, really hard to take this narrow path. It was very hard. And the very thing that I kept clinging to, and it was the argument I used, was narrows the path, you know, to righteousness, and broad was the way to leads to destruction. That was what I hung on to during those rough years as a Christian.
Yeah. You mentioned in there about things like the Harry Potter books, which is fun. Like, a lot of Christians I know are very against them. It's very obvious witchcraft, so it seems quite amusing that they wouldn't see it. But there's a lot of things around like that. There's actually more and more, I don't know, over there, but kids shows even that where they've got little characters, and I'm talking like children, like, but toddlers show, TV shows where they've got little characters that levitate and everything, like really weird stuff. And it's getting more and more dominant, and particularly with TV and movies and stuff these days. I know that some people stand by the thought that, it doesn't matter, it's just a TV show, it's not going to hurt them. We teach them the truth, so they know better, they know right from wrong, they know what's right. What do you think Scripture says about that? And should we be getting our children to avoid things like that, or TV in general and stuff? And what effect do you think it has on them? Sorry, that was a few questions all in one.
No, I perfectly understand it. You know, to the people that think it's okay to watch these movies with this type of thing in it, witchcraft and levitation and all this, to those people, I would simply say, sure, if you're going to sit there beside your child during the whole show and point out every little thing, because what you're doing by letting the child watch this stuff is you are, by proxy, condoning everything that's in the show.
Yeah.
It goes back to Hasatan is after the little children. you notice they put more of that stuff in little children's movies and shows. Walt Disney's been, you know, making the path to make that stuff okay for years, you know, since the very first, you know, movie that's ever been put out. Every movie there is, there's some kind of witchcraft. I mean, I can think of a couple, maybe two or three, that didn't have witchcraft of some sort in it or some type of thing in it. But and what's really scary is with what I know now, and I look back just for an example, the Snow White in the beginning of the movie where the fairies, each one comes to give them a gift. Well, that's where giving a gift on birthdays, that's how it started. It was actually demonic demons, and it wasn't the gift being given to the person. It was a gift given to the demon controlling that person. Oh, wow. In those areas. Like in the movie, I don't remember now, but they had areas of talent or abilities or beauty or long life. Well, these are all the things that they believe were controlled by demons. So they were giving gifts to that demon to bestow upon that person. And, you know, that one didn't want to be nice, so she cursed, you know. But I'm sorry, I just want to put that in there. That's my little pitch against birthdays, is because that's where that, you know, that bears that out. That's where Walt Disney got that idea. But the witchcraft today, you know, I turned the TV off. We had cable 30 years ago. Maybe it was more like 25. I don't know how old my oldest son was. We came home and he turned on the TV, and we had a thing called MTV, and I understand it's not like that anymore, but I saw him watching things on the TV, and he turned the TV on himself, and he's just a little child, you know. And I could not believe it. I'm thinking, this is programming. We canceled our cable TV back then. I guess it's been 25 years. And because, you know, and there was things even before that happened, I'd watch TV with him, and there was like little commercials, even the commercials, there would be little things like Johnny's doing something in his room, and his mother saying, come on, take out the trash. But he's doing something else. And he's looking at I'm not going to do that. I'm going to finish what I'm doing right now. And he's looking at the camera like bringing you in as a co-conspirator. It's the child in the room watching the TV teaming up with that rebellious child on the TV. So you're one and the same. And whatever product that was he had in his ring, it wasn't important. The message was, don't listen to your parents. You do whatever it is that you want to do in your room. And TV programming is just filled with those subliminal little messages.
Yeah.
That's my opinion of TV. You know, and if you don't, do you have time for a little story?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I'll try to make it short. I've been trying to write a blog about it, and I just can't do it. Maybe if I say it out loud. But if you don't think TV programs your mind, when I was a child, my stepfather had just come from World War. I was a World War II baby, basically, you know. But my stepfather, he wasn't my real father, but he had been in the front lines, and so the only thing he ever wanted to watch on TV when I was a child were war movies. And there was even TV series, you know, about war. I don't remember the name of it, but there was shows about, you know, the war and the front lines. But in all these war movies, they would always show these planes flying overhead. And everybody, when the plane would fly overhead, everybody would stop and look to see, was that an enemy or was that an ally? You know, friend or foe? And then they just sigh relief or they'd hit the ground. And every movie, and we watched every movie that ever came out. Jump forward to when I'm, you know, 30 years later, actually longer than that probably, and I'm out in a field in Atherton High School with playing with my children. We're all playing. The whole family's there. We're kicking the ball or playing with the dog or whatever. And where we live was real close to Bowman Field, where a small aircraft airport. Mm-hmm. And every time a plane would fly over, I would stop. And I would just have to find that plane. I would just look around the sky until I found the plane. And then I'd look at the plane, and I'd have to watch that plane until it was out of sight. Yeah. I mean, I was just paralyzed. I had to look at that plane. And I never even noticed my behavior. I never even paid attention to what I was doing. And years later, now we've moved, and we're in a different home, and then planes go by very rarely, but one day, when the small planes were gathering, they had this thunder over Louisville, and I was watching the planes, and I saw one that was supposed to be from a war, you know. And it hit me. I said, "I know what I'm doing. I'm watching these planes to see if they're enemy or ally." And I would be paralyzed until it was past to see if it was going to bomb me or come to rescue me.
Yeah.
And it was so subliminal, I didn't even know I was doing that behavior. So if you don't think TV has an effect on your child, think about that. Mm. I didn't know it had an effect on me. And I'm sure my parents didn't know that it was going to, you know, who knew?
Yeah.
But it because what you're watching, it's your eyes, ears, you know, and your emotion. It gets your emotions involved. And it's a wonderful teaching tool for good or for evil.
Yes. Okay. Well, that was wonderful. Thank you for sharing that.
I'm not condemning TV. I'm condemning what you the parents that just let their child turn loose with the remote control.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
We always raised our children with videos that we saw and approved. Of course, I thought Disney was okay. I didn't know. But, you know, we did a lot of things I wish I could go back and change. But, yeah, my children only watched what they could see. And when Adam was, I don't even know how old he was, 10, 11, 12, 13, I don't know how old he was. But we were saying, well, you know, you can watch that on regular TV. And he said, "What's TV?" You know, because he's thinking, isn't this what we're doing? And we had explained to him what TV was because he'd never seen TV programming.
Yeah. My kids are like that, in that they're watching a DVD. And they must have flicked it onto the TV somehow the other day. And I didn't realize it had gone onto TV. But they were watching a cartoon, like a kid's movie on the TV then. So they just thought, you know, they kept watching. All of a sudden, the ad comes on. They come running into me. "There's something wrong with it. What's going on? It's stopped. It's not working in the middle of the movie." I'm coming in going, "What's wrong?" And I had a look and I realized they'd flicked the TV. And I said, "Oh, this is the TV." And they're going, "No, it's not." We're having this big argument about the fact about these ads. By the time we'd gotten to the end of me trying to explain it to them, the show had come back on. They go, "Oh, it's okay, now it's fixed. Off you go." And then it happens 10 minutes later, and they're like, "It's happened again." So it's quite amusing. They didn't understand
it.
That
is so cute.
But then the one or two ads that they picked up on there, Josiah's going, "I want this thing, and I want that thing." And I'm going, "Oh, this is why we don't watch TV." I couldn't believe it from that one time, how much they wanted and saw. And some of the stuff, like what you were saying, some of the stuff that they've said, and I've looked at the shows they're watching, I'm thinking, wow, it is very subliminal, like the messages that go through, and you just wonder, my goodness, like even things like, yeah, someone will have a birthday in the show and they're all having a party and it's so much fun, and then the kids will be like, oh, birthdays are fun, I want to have a party, what are we doing for my birthday? And so you're kind of like, well, we don't do it, but it's fun. So then it's sort of you're creating your own enemy by doing it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Create monsters.
Mm.
Well, so I guess it's best to, you know, when they get older, mm. you know, I think it's different. But that programming as for the very young of mine, because it's so, they just take it all in, mm. you know. They're just like sponges, and they just suck it up, whatever it is. I want to do it. I want this. I want that. I want to be like this. I want, yeah. I see my grandchildren, and I see them very much influenced by things that they've seen on TV.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry for it, but, you know, my son has a different opinion, you know. I mean, he's very restrictive.
Yeah.
You know, he's, you know, Michael's very restrictive what they watch, but even that, like you said, the commercials
mm.
are very influencing.
Well, it's been great to talk today. It took a different direction there, but that was very interesting to hear about that, what you were saying, all your stories. Is there anything else you wanted to add to any of that?
No, I really can't think of anything much. Let me see what else Liz
yeah.
written down here for me.
Great.
Let me look at this, because This is very good. If I can just share this with you,
yeah.
It says in Psalm 25:8, it says, "My eyes are ever toward Yahuwah, for He brings my feet out of the net. Turn Your face to me and show me favor, for I am lonely and afflicted. The distresses of my heart have enlarged. Oh, bring me out of my distresses. Look on my affliction and my toil, and forgive all my sins. See how many my enemies have become, how they hate me with a violent hatred. O guard my life and deliver me. Let me not be ashamed, for I have taken refuge in You. Let integrity and straightness guard me, for I have waited for You. Redeem Israel, O Elohim, out of all his distresses." And that was Psalms 25:8-22.
Wonderful.
And, wait a minute, what was that? You know, our defenses is His name, because it says His name is a strong tower. I'm sorry, my accent's getting on me. His name is a strong tower, and I run to it. You asked me what advice I give people. That's another piece of advice I gave to someone. And that was a very strong, you know, for me to tell them that, because I literally, when I'm feeling hurt or lonely, or I just literally imagine in my mind a tower, and I picture myself going inside of it and being comforted,
mm-hmm.
you know, by His name. And here's another reminder, something else for us to think about, because we all need this, whether we're persecuted or not. So when we pray, we are wearing the armor of Elohim. When we pray for our persecutors, our own heart changes toward them. Because of this, take up the complete armor of Elohim, so that you have power to withstand in the wicked day, and having done all, to stand. So that's Ephesians 6:13. Well, prior to that, he describes, you know, what you're taking up when you take up the armor.
Yeah.
And so that's, you know, regardless of whatever it is we're doing in life, when you've done the right thing, you pray and ask Yahuwah, making sure that your footsteps were right. And then when you've done all that you can do, you just stand. You just trust him. You just cover yourself in his love and his mercy. And you just stand there and don't change. You know, a lot of people think that they're berating Lou is going to make him change his path, because what they don't realize is he's serving Yahusha. What he's doing for Yahusha.
Yeah.
And I think that's the test on Lou's test, is to see if he'll be swayed.
Mm.
You know, and it's like going through a fire. He said that he would take us through a fire until we were like, what is it, burnished silver?
Yeah.
Is that, and what I understand that to mean is he's just getting rid of all the, what is it called, the gloss or what?
Yeah,
imperfections.
Yeah.
Okay. Whatever the word is, he's burning out the imperfections, and it's tough. Lou's going through a really, really tough time, and I'm going through it with him. You know, how could I possibly understand what Lou's going through if I wasn't also being taken through it?
Yeah.
So that's another reason for rejoicing.
Yeah.
Because he loves us enough to be testing us and putting us through this. You know, if everything was easy, you might wonder, why is it so easy? You know, maybe you could just either you've reached perfection,
mm-hmm.
or maybe you're not, you know, maybe he's not thinking about you enough to, because he said he'll do this to you until you have his reflection.
Yeah.
So we're, like I said, it's, here's exactly what I was talking about. See, Lou was preparing for this.
Mm-hmm.
It's 1 Peter 4:12-13 says, beloved ones, do not suppose for a trial that is coming upon you to try you, as though some unusual matter has befallen you, but as you share Messiah's sufferings, rejoice, in order that you might rejoice exultingly at the revelation of his esteem. There's a nice little picture of the fire. But, you know, that was, you know, when it says Genesis 28, well, I already read that to you, because he said he would not leave you. Yeah, I think this is kind of cool, because Lou spent some time going through a lot of scripture that I asked him to help me with.
Yeah.
And in Psalm 35:11 says, ruthless witnesses rise up. They ask me that which I knew not. They reward me evil for good, bereaving my life. But I, when they were sick, I put on sackcloth. I humbled my being with fastings, and my prayer would return to my own bosom. I walked about as though he were my friend or brother. This is how we treat, you know, our so-called enemies. I bowed down mourning as one mourning for a mother, but they rejoiced at my stumbling and gathered together. The smiters gathered against me, and I did not know it. They tore in pieces without ceasing, and with unclean ones, mockers at feast, gnashing at me with their teeth. Yahuwah, how long would you look on? Rescue my being from their destructions, my only life from the lions. I give you thanks in the great assembly. I praise you among a mighty people. Let not my lying enemies rejoice over me, or those who hate me without cause wink their eyes. For they do not speak peace, but they devise words of deceit against the peaceable ones of the land. And they opened their mouth wide against me, and they said, aha, aha, our eyes have seen it. This you have seen, O Yehud. Do not be silent, O Yehud. Do not be far from me. So see, this persecution, it's thousands of years old.
Yeah.
You know, David was writing that, you know, he was going through some persecution too from Saul, and Saul didn't even know why he was doing that because he was mad, you know. When I say mad, insane, I believe. He would have demons would come on him, and he'd be attacking David and try to kill him, and then go, oh, I didn't mean that, you know. So we can't blame the people who are persecuting us. We can't be angry. I guess this goes back to your earlier question, to be angry. We can be angry, but we can't be angry at flesh and blood. They're not our enemies. It's powers and principalities that are coming against us. And you know what? And also, I think Yahuwah is allowing it to happen for a time being, like I said, to test us, to strengthen us.
Wonderful. It's a wonderful way to look at it, what you're saying, like that you want to be persecuted because you know you're on the right path and you know that he's strengthening you and he's interested in getting rid of those, taking you through the fire and getting rid of those spots and wrinkles. So that's how you, I guess, you rejoice when it's happening because you see why it's happening and that, you know, you've got the right information. I think it's wonderful. Just a really great way to look at it.
It's hard. I tell you what, if it weren't for Lou and I and Adam, the three of us strengthening each other, reminding each other, you know, we all help each other. And remind each other how we should act, but Lou's the pillar of strength.
Yeah.
He is just, he's amazing. He really is. And he never, ever feels any anger.
Yeah.
He never has gotten angry. He's just been like incredible. Like, what? You know, where are they even coming from? And the lies that are trumped up. You know, and people call me and say, well, I saw it on the internet. I say, well, yeah, you can put anything you want on the internet. You know, anybody can say anything they want to and put it up on the internet.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just incredible. And it's just like Satan to take a grain of truth and then pack it in with a whole bunch of lies. And, well, this part's true. Well, then all this other part's true, too. No.
Yeah.
You know. Oh, and just this person that was persecuting me so strongly that got me so upset. I was answering back honestly, you know, all their questions, innocently answering all their questions, just to say, and they said, and they told me. The last email that I refused to read anymore after that, but the very last thing they told me when they started, that this was before I knew that they were a persecutor type person. And so then they started getting ugly. And then they said, well, I've got all your words now I can use against you. And I said, okay, so he can take any of my emails, anything I wrote out, change, you know, and... Well, he can just put he or she, I don't know if it's man or woman, because he wouldn't reveal himself. And, you know, how brave is that?
Mm-hmm.
So you can, but the very fact that he's got an email from me, he can change and make it say, like I said, anything.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And that stinks. That's really stinky.
Yeah.
You know, and I wrote him back when I read that. I said, I'm not afraid of you. You know, I'm not afraid of you. You're so, you know, you can't even reveal your own self. You're so fearful you can't reveal who you are. I'm not afraid of you.
Mm.
So.
They've obviously got something to hide.
Yeah, obviously. That person is hiding.
Mm.
And we're... Lou and people like yourself and now Mark and you guys are targets. Anybody that's willing to be open and honest, that they're easy targets.
Yeah.
But don't be afraid. Yehun is for you.
Yeah.
If Yehun is for you, who can be against you?
Yeah. It's wonderful. I was just thinking then, if someone was to face a physical persecution, what would you tell them to do? Can they defend? Do you think it's right for them to defend themselves? Or should they just stand and take it? Or
that's a tricky question. You mean physical?
So if they're like physically getting hurt or physically getting abused for it.
Well, you know, I've never had to face that. I know that Yahushua said if someone strikes you in the cheek, turn the other cheek. Mm-hmm. And I know Stephen had to stand there and get stoned. And he prayed for them as they were, you know, remember Stephen when he spoke, he was using the name, yeah. And they were stoning. And Paul was one of the people holding everybody's coats. Yeah. You know, they took off their garments and gave them to Paul, you know, because he didn't know any better. And so he was saying, Father, forgive them, you know, please do not be angry with them. And when Yahushua, when he was dying on the stake, he said, Father, forgive them, for he didn't strike back. I mean, he could have destroyed he could have just wiped them out, you know, just, he wouldn't have had to even lift a hand.
Yeah.
And he could have just, you know, he wouldn't even had to kill him. All he would have had to do is just make him fall down. He wouldn't have had to hurt them. He could have stopped it.
Mm.
I don't know. I can't tell you any from my experience because I've not had to. I don't think I'm a very good, I think I would be one to just put up my hands and take the beating because I don't fight back. I can't physically hurt another person. I've tried. When I was a little kid, I used to get beat up and picked on and ridiculed as a child because I was different, because I was real poor and I had to wear hand-me-down clothes and the clothes didn't match what everybody else wore to school. And so people picked on me and you know, they'd throw rocks and fight. You know, I never defended myself. I just walked away. So that's my nature. So, you know, I might be the wrong person to ask. You might to get a real rounded opinion.
Yeah.
You know, I'd like to see Mark ask Lou that question.
Okay.
I'm going to ask Lou that question as soon as we get through talking. Now, I know he agrees that you can defend someone that's being hurt or, you know, like he's always been a believer that you can defend your family.
Yeah.
Because Yahuwah said if someone climbs in your window in the darkness of night, whatever the reason that they're in there for, you have a right to take their life.
Oh, okay.
That's Torah.
Yeah.
You know? So apparently Yahuwah believes it's okay to defend your family.
Yeah. Okay. Wonderful.
But I would never like do anything. If somebody did something dirty to me, I don't think I'd ever do anything dirty back. I don't know. Oh, it's making me feel sick to my stomach thinking about it. I don't know. Change the subject. I can't imagine what it would be like if somebody actually started being physically abusive.
Yeah. I think there's just with the internet these days, a lot of people just hide behind that and they can say and do what they want, like you said, is happening. So it's probably not as big a thing these days. People don't have to reveal themselves if they're online.
Right.
So it's easier for them to do that than to do anything else. Safer for them.
Right.
Oh, that's wonderful. Fantastic. I have thoughts in my head, but I don't know how to get it all together to ask any more questions there. So I think you've covered everything that I was thinking of, and it sounds like it's wonderful advice that you've given to us all, and just the supporting and then like reminding each other and supporting each other and reminding of what Torah says and what to do and how to feel and why it's happening is wonderful. Like, you know, just to be able to be there for each other. So that's great.
You know, the most wonderful thing that's come from all this persecution has been the overwhelming pouring of love and support from the community. You know, you and Mark, Colin, and there's been many, many people. I don't want to name their names. They might not want to be named on a video, but many people have called me and told me, I'm standing with you. I'm with you. I'm with you. People I never even knew, you know, of course, they wouldn't have had to say one thing or the other, you know, but some people have said, I listened to them and now, but then I see that they're just so ridiculous that I'm sorry I listened to them. Now I know it was just, it's gotten too out of hand, but I do want to say one thing. If all those people that are listening to this, thank you. Every phone call, every email that's ever come to say, we're behind you, we're with you, we're praying for you, it just brings tears to my eyes because I never knew people loved us that much. Mm. You know, it's just so, it's so wonderful to feel loved.
Yes.
So, you see, the enemy is not winning. He is not winning. We're just being told how much people really love us. Where maybe they wouldn't have had a reason to before.
Yeah.
You know, we've heard so many stories that just as a result of this, to see that that's our reward, you know.
Yeah.
I hope I expressed myself. I was getting too emotional. I'm sorry.
No, it's wonderful. That's wonderful. Just
thank you. Okay. And thanks to you and Mark for doing these because it lets me express how, just like I just did, how much I appreciate the support.
It's wonderful to hear that you're getting that. I'm really happy to hear that you are here getting that from people. So,
sorry I didn't mention it in the beginning.
Oh, no, it's wonderful to hear. Yeah. That's great. Well, I think on that note, we will wrap it up.
Okay.
So I think that's a lovely note to finish it on.
All right. Well, it's to see you.
Yeah, it's been wonderful chatting and seeing you again, and I've really enjoyed it today. You've given us some great things to think about, and great stuff to walk away with. So I've learned a lot. Thank you.
All right. Well, have a wonderful, blessed day.
Thank you, you too. And were you coming to the end of Sabbath now?
We've got a couple more hours. I think it's 7 o'clock, and I've got just a little more than an hour.
Oh, so wonderful. Well, enjoy the rest of your Sabbath.
Yeah, Lou and I'll probably go outside and just enjoy being outside. Mm. It's turned out to be a lovely day.
Oh, wonderful. Well, have a nice day and some time together. And I'll see you in a few weeks.
All right.
Talk on the email anyway.
All right. Well, thank you.
We love you too, sister. So make sure you remember that every time something comes through, all the love and support you've got.
I will. Love you. Shalom.
Shalom. He is good. He is